from Canberra, Australia, which is where all our engineering runs out of. We have an office here in Redwood City as well, so I've come out for the conference. Been with Instaclustr about 2 years. My background before that is sort of 20 years in various architecture and development roles, particularly in the business analytics, data warehouse kind of space. 10 years of that with Accenture, working mainly for government clients. But only came across Cassandra with Instaclustr. And happy to say that I'm a DataStax MVP for this year, so I've been doing a bit and pleased to get that recognition. So as I mentioned, the sort of agenda for today will be, first of all, just to talk a bit about generally load testing, things to think about, things that I've learned through the years and we've learned at Instaclustr. We often have to do load testing as we're introducing new configurations, those types of things. Secondly, with that kind of general background of load testing any application, what are some of the Cassandra-specific considerations that you need to keep in mind? And certainly, I've been caught a couple of times, and we've been caught in Instaclustr a couple of times, missing some things that are specific to Cassandra that we've learned along the way, which I think are useful to people to know. And then thirdly, walk through cassandra-stress and talk about actually what some of those settings mean in cassandra-stress and how to use that to actually do load testing. So the first thing I want to go through about load testing is why load test. And I think it's useful to, when you've set about planning a load test, to think about what the purpose is. And to me, there's kind of four different reasons you could do it. First one, which is probably the one that we do most commonly at Instaclustr, is to benchmark to compare configurations. So when we change to a different release a different Cassandra version, or we look at changing the file system, or we recently did some tuning on disk reader head settings. We want to have reliable benchmarks that allow us to establish what's the difference in performance as we make each of those little individual tweaks there. So getting that baseline and being able to measure the difference in the changes you made is one key reason why you want load tests. The second one, probably the one that springs to mind to a lot of people, is to prove your ability to handle forecast peak application load. So you're about to release an application, you think there's going to be 10,000 things per second happening on that application. You want to know that your infrastructure is capable of handling that load, and to give assurance to yourself and to the business that yes, you're ready to meet that. Third one is to prove the application stability under a sustained production load. Probably a slight tweak on the first one. So the previous one, there's one thing being able to measure, to perform at a peak. There's another thing checking that you don't have memory leaks, that things just remain stable running over a very long period of time. And it's another reason why you might want to do load testing. And then the fourth one was establishing parameters for capacity forecasting models. So a key thing that probably all of us do at some time in the operations space is having to work out, well, if my application load increases by 2 times in terms of the number of business transactions happening, what does that mean for the level of hardware that I need, those types of things for your forecasting model. And so each of those different reasons for load testing is going to slightly change the way that you actually construct your load test and what you go about testing. For the first one, benchmarking configurations, you probably want a pretty simple, stable test that allows you to be very sure that you've isolated the impact of the tuning that you've made, and then maybe validate that with a more complex, more real-life application test. Whereas obviously your ability to handle peak application load, you want to be simulating the actual application load as closely as you can, so there's no unforeseen difference in a true live load that bites you when you're live in production. Certainly my first step in planning a load test is think about which of those purpose, what is the purpose of the load test, and probably fitting it into one of those categories. So then when you've sort of understood why you're doing the load test, what are the things you need to think about to actually plan the load test? The key ones, and some of these can come into the Cassandra-specific considerations, but you obviously need to understand your peak load that you're aiming for. This is if you're doing an application, trying to establish that you can meet an application load. You need to understand the data demographics. That's very important once you're getting into a database. Am I skewed to a particular you know, is one client 1,000 times bigger than the average client? That's definitely going to impact you, and so you need to be thinking about that. You need to understand your production hardware configuration. Again, if you're looking to validate, will this work in production or build a forecasting model, you need to understand that how does this hardware that you're using for load testing relate to the hardware that you're actually planning to use in production, and what are the performance characteristics? So that kind of gives you the parameters to drive how much load you want to put in there. Then you have to think about your options for generating load. In a lot of circumstances, well, again, this comes back to why you're doing the load test, but one option is to drive load through the application. And certainly if you want to validate that things are going to work under a production load, driving load from the very front as far as you can through the application is the most valid way to do that. Anything that's just driving Cassandra or just driving your database can always work, even if you think you've got the parameters tuned perfectly, can always work just that little bit differently, and things work differently in production. So if you want to simulate a production load and validate that things are going to work in production, then the closer you can get to having people clicking buttons on browsers or whatever it is that's the end of your chain is going to be a better thing there. That's not always going to be possible for various reasons. So then your next possibility is to actually create more of a custom harness. So you might actually be able to sort of shim out part of your application, still use a good chunk of your application code and have something automatically generating load there. Again, that might give you higher confidence that the type of load that you're simulating is closer to what your real production load is going to be. And then the other options are tools like cassandra-stress, or also there's another tool called JMeter, which does database testing, which is testing right down at your database layer. And those database tools, again, can help you with things like forecasting models and those kind of things. Very good for benchmarking, where you want to, benchmarking tweaks in your Cassandra configuration, where you want to make sure that you've isolated down to a pretty simple case and you can really, really tell what it is that the impact is of any change that you're making. So all of those are really valid options, and I wouldn't say one of these is better or worse. It really depends on your outcome and which is the right tool for the particular job. Test environment sizing is always a question that comes up with this kind of thing. And I think, obviously testing on a full production size if you're looking to validate a load is the best validation. With Cassandra, I think most people who run it in production would say you're confident enough with the linear scaling that you'd be happy with a 30 or 50% scale test and to be confident that it could scale up with there, provided that you're also happy that you've made good use of you've done a good data model and the way that you're using Cassandra scales properly. And Jonathan talked about some of the things this morning, like secondary indexes that can prevent you scaling. So you need to be, if you're doing a smaller size load test, be very confident that you haven't used some of those features and you're not going to scale the way you expect. So next, some tips for executing a load test. I think that my number one tip, learnt the hard way many times, is record everything. I think it's very common. I've seen this when I've run load tests, when I've had people in my team running load tests, kind of get to the end and go, those results are a bit strange, why is that? And then we want to know the parameter that was used for this little thing down there and it wasn't recorded, and then there's days of work to go back and rerun the thing again. So I think you can't over-record what you're doing when you're running a load test. It's amazing. Virtually every load test I've been involved with, we've ended up taking longer than expected because we're rerunning stuff because we didn't know exactly what happened or it wasn't tuned, and it takes a long time to do these things. Test is a minimum of 2 or 3 hours in most cases to get a realistic thing. So recording as much as you can and knowing what's going on is important. Second one, ensuring that the load client is not a bottleneck. So it's kind of easy to think to think that you're stressing the server which you're trying to test, and actually it's the load client that's the problem there. And there's various different ways you can check that. One is that I've used is to just spin up a second load client running at the same time and see whether that impacts the performance of the first one, because if the servers at maxed out, then adding a second client should reduce the amount of throughput that can come from the first client. You can obviously look at things like CPU utilization and those kind of things on the load client itself to make sure that that's not a bottleneck, but that's certainly something you always want to keep an eye on when you're running a load test. Third one, understand the natural variance between tests. Definitely, if you're running in a cloud environment, most of what we do is in a cloud environment in particular, but in just about any environment, you'll see variance from test to test. And you need to understand, particularly if you're doing that benchmarking, trying to understand the effect of tuning different parameters, you need to understand what that variance is between tests and is the difference between test one and test two, just the natural variance that I'm going to get running the test in exactly the same way time and time again, or is that actually an impact of the change that I've made? So you'll almost certainly have to run multiple tests with these identical parameters and understand what the variance is that happens just from the natural difference in the environment. And particularly in cloud environments, you'll see more variance than you will if you're running on bare metal in your data center and that's the only thing that's going on, you're not sharing with anything else. And then the fourth one I'd say is make sure you understand the bottleneck in the system under load. So if you're trying to understand the peak capacity of your system and you think you've hit that, you should be able to identify what is the thing that I've hit there. You'll have hit the I/O limit, you'll have hit a limit of CPU usage, you'll be causing garbage collection. There'll be something that is a system resource that should be maxed out, and you should be able to, without too much effort, pinpoint what that is. To make sure, that's useful for saying, well, how do I get more capacity? But it also, I think, illustrates that you've really understood what's going on in your test environment. You know what you've done. So I think if you can't pinpoint that, you probably need to work a little bit on just understanding what's going on in the environment to understand where the bottleneck is and that it's not at the load client or some other thing that you don't realize in the environment. Okay, so that was it on the kind of general load testing things. Hopefully I didn't tell everybody stuff they'd already known, but mistakes that I've made a couple of times, so maybe there's something in there. The next thing I wanted to go into is some Cassandra-specific considerations and what are some particular things you should keep in mind when designing a load test and running a load test for Cassandra. So the first one is background operations. So presumably most people know what compactions and repairs are in Cassandra, and Jonathan's slide this morning was a great illustration of, with level compaction strategy, looks like it's going great for how it was the first 1.5 terabytes of load, and then suddenly through the floor as compactions really started to kick in and those kind of things. And I've certainly seen that many times in running load tests myself. I can throw data in forever, but then it takes days for the compactions to catch up in some circumstances. So you need to make sure as you're writing data in a Cassandra load test that you're monitoring the level of pending compactions, that you're not fooling yourself that you can write it at 1,000 or 100,000 transactions per second when in fact you're backing up a world of compactions that in real life eventually would just break your cluster. If the pending compactions are continually increasing, you don't have enough capacity to serve that level of writes. You have to be writing a level that keeps the pending compactions at between sort of 0 and 5 kind of thing. Anything above that and you're probably getting into unhealthy state. Repairs is a similar thing. If you're trying to understand what is the maximum load my system can bear in production, you have to remember that you're going to have to run repairs to keep the cluster consistent, and that is going to take capacity out of serving the application. In some applications where you've got peaks and troughs and demand, that might not be too much of a problem. You can schedule repairs out of hours, particularly with incremental repairs that run relatively fast. You might be able to use the troughs of capacity to run your repairs. But if you're in, say, the IoT space and you've got a very constant stream of data coming in and you've got to keep that constant performance, then you need to make sure that you've tested that you can maintain that constant performance while running repairs. And keep in mind that repairs can behave a bit differently depending on the data conditions, so you probably don't want to just run one repair and think it's all good. Run them a few times, see how different it goes, and you get a bit of confidence in that. Second thing to keep in mind with Cassandra is some of the data conditions that can impact performance. So tombstones, so anyone that's been around Cassandra for a while, has probably seen the impact that tombstones can have on performance, tombstones being the markers for deletes that are stored in the SS tables. And it can be a massive difference between running a select on a table that's just been nicely populated with fresh data and running a select on a table that's been populated with fresh data, then had a bunch of data deleted or updated in some circumstances, and has a lot of tombstones in it. So in planning your Cassandra test, this is one where running it through the application good example of why that would help, because your application, if it's going to do deletes, would probably do that when you run from the application side. But if you're just testing on the pure Cassandra end, make sure you understand whether the application is going to do deletes, what level of deletes it's going to do, whether it's going to do updates, and you build that into your performance test, because that will have a significant impact on performance if you hit a decent level of tombstones. Skewed partitions. So again, Cassandra often is very, very easy and lovely to run when you've got nice small partitions that are evenly spread and everything's happy. But probably the biggest problem that we see running clusters in production for our customers is when we have skewed partitions or overly large partitions. So, you know, that thing where most of your clients have 10 orders each and you have one massive client that's got a million orders and that partition is 100 megabytes big, the reads out of that are probably going to be slower. When that thing hits compactions, it's going to cause rumbles, those kind of things. So really that goes back to before the load test, back to the data modeling stage, but I guess load testing is often validating the data modeling, and so definitely something, if you're doing the load testing and you didn't do the data modeling, or even if you did, recheck, is there a possibility of skewed partitions here, or really large partitions, and if there is, make sure that your simulation parameters test the bounds of that, of how big those partitions are likely to get, and make sure things still work in those circumstances. And then the third one, cache hit rates, including the operating system cache. So another thing you'll see change the difference is, and it's sort of obvious when you say it, is that reading, doing 1,000 reads out of a very small amount of data can happen very quickly, but when those reads are spread over, say, a terabyte of data, even if they're tiny reads sitting on disk, and it's the terabyte isn't going to keep cached in memory, it changes the performance drastically. So you do need to make sure that before you start doing read tests, you've written a volume of data to disk that is reasonably representative of what's going to be sitting on the disk in production, and that you sort of sample out of that data in a reasonably represented pattern. Otherwise, you end up with the circumstance where you've got an SS table sitting on disk, it all looks good, but it's actually all got sucked into the operating system file cache, and everything's actually operating in memory, and it looks like it's running really fast. Then when you add more data, it runs nowhere near as fast. And that's another lesson learned the hard way, but it can happen there. And then third one, and so this is going back to the point I made before about the non or poorly scaling operations. So again, particularly if you're relying on extrapolating from a smaller cluster to performance on a bigger cluster, these are things that you really, really want to watch out for. So firstly, secondary indexes, and I'm sure Jonathan did a better job of explaining the scaling of those this morning than me, but unless you use them in a very particular way, they don't scale, basically, beyond a certain point. Logged batches, another similar thing, as your cluster scales, particularly if you're doing larger batches, more nodes that have to be coordinated to make a log batch work, so the performance of log batches can actually get worse as your cluster scales out. Multi-partition queries, similar things, so using the in clause, say, if you've got an RF3 and three nodes, the in clause is all going to pull the data from one node anyway. As soon as you scale that out to 30 nodes, that in clause might end up pulling data from 10 nodes and joining that on a coordinator, and the coordinator's got a whole bunch of memory to allocate, and things slow down a lot. So those things are big things to watch out for. User-defined functions and user-defined aggregates. To be honest, I haven't seen a lot of them in production yet to understand really the performance characteristics, but I'm sure there are ways to build UDFs and UDAs that don't scale. If I was doing a performance test of a application that was using UDFs and UDAs, I'd be looking at those things very carefully to work out, do they scale? What's the performance characteristics of these things? Okay, so with that as the sort of Cassandra-specific considerations to sort of keep in the background, I wanted to next move on to Cassandra-stress and sort of walking through how to use Cassandra-stress to keep in mind some of those things and what does it do. So firstly, what is Cassandra-stress? So Cassandra-stress is comes with Cassandra. When you install Cassandra, you get Cassandra Stress as a tool. And it provides the ability to basically create a synthetic load directly against Cassandra. It's a very flexible tool, and you can do a whole range of different scenarios. Although, you know, as I've mentioned a few times, it's still not a perfect substitute for testing through your application. You'd probably never be completely confident that the load that you generated Cassandra Stress was the same characteristics as the load that your application was generated. But you can certainly tune it in a lot of different ways to get pretty close. And certainly for that, it's, I think, where it comes from. What it's really good for is that benchmarking scenario where you want to have a very repeatable load, and it can be quite a complex repeatable load, and then tweak some settings and see what the impact of tweaking those settings is. The perfect fit is Cassandra Stress. So it supports this. It's almost two tools rolled into one once you get underneath the hood. There's the sort of legacy commands, which are read, write, and mixed, and that basically will create a schema for you and load some data in that schema, and you can change the population scenarios and those kind of things. And then there's kind of the new version, which is using a YAML configuration to specify a load against a table of your choosing, and it can generate load against basically any table there. It even has neat features like graphing results. I mainly mentioned so I could get a picture into my slides because it was all text up till then, but there's a lot of features in there in Cassandra Stress. It takes, I've dedicated a fair bit of time to trying to get my head around it, including writing some patches and things to understand it. So it takes a little bit to work through, but it is quite a powerful tool once you can understand it. One of the current limitations is that it can only stress one table at a time. So you can have a single YAML file and you can specify, which specifies a single table, and you can do that. I actually just on the weekend submitted a patch to the Cassandra project to do multiple tables at one point in time. So hopefully that'll hit the trunk fairly soon and be able to do that. So, as I said, the key, I think, for most scenarios, the kind of new way of using Cassandra Stress is to use the YAML file. The old way is good for if you want a really quick test, and probably most of use to the Cassandra team. For most people who are actually building an application trying to understand a particular table impact, then the YAML file is probably the way to go. So I was just going to walk through the components of those YAML files and what they mean, because they're not entirely obvious. So you start off with a key space definition, which is pretty straightforward. You just have to provide the key space name and the create SQL for the key space. If you've already got the key space created, you don't actually have to provide the SQL again. And then the same thing for the table, just the name. And if you're actually going to want Cassandra Stress to create the table for you, then you have to provide the create SQL in there, or you can have it already existing in the key space. So then you get into the more interesting part, which is the column spec section, which is where it actually specifies the data generation parameters for what data it's going to generate for the table. And what Cassandra Stress actually does behind the scenes when you run a stress run is to effectively pre-generate a whole bunch of data in memory, which it then kind of runs through and either does the inserts on the queries against that. So this is specifying that pre-generation that's happening there. So in this example, the first column in our table is host, and size specifies the size of the data that will be generated to go into that column. So in this case, fixed 32, so every bit of data will be 32 characters wide. Fixed is the name of a distribution. So fixed is the sort of simplest distribution. It's always going to be 32 characters. There's some other examples in there, such as uniform, which is any number from 1 to 600 in that next example, with equal probability of any one of those numbers. And Gaussian, which is your bell curve distribution. So that Gaussian example down the bottom there, 1,000 to 2,000, means any number from 1,000 to 2,000. With a bell curve distribution, so the numbers in the middle are more likely to be picked for any one point in time. So any of those distributions can be used to specify the size. So in this case, we've just said a fixed size, and then the population. Now the population is actually took me a while to get this one straight, but the distribution for provide for population is the distribution of the seed values, which go into a random generator to generate something of that length. So when I say population uniform 1 to 600, it doesn't mean the population will be a set of numbers from 1 to 600. The 1 to 600 will go into the random generator to generate bytes of 32 length. So you'll get 600 different random sets of bytes of 32 characters in length from that first column spec there. The next one, bucket time, does a similar thing, fixed 18. For this one, I actually introduced the sequential generator, which is another new one, which was another thing I contributed to Cassandra Stress. What that will do is sequentially go from 1 to 288 as your seeds, so that you'll know you'll get the same bytes in every order. The reason I introduced that, and that's the way the old Cassandra Stress commands worked for writes, is so that you don't get any double up when you're inserting data. So if you want to, I mentioned you need to have enough data on disk to roughly represent what you're going to have in production. So typically you start off a load by just writing a whole bunch of data onto the cluster to get that later up. If you're using one of the random distributions, when you do that, you'll of course get double ups because they're just randomly picking values. So at best, you'll end up having to do a whole bunch of writes that you didn't really want to do to do that. And at worst, and this is kind of what I did for quite a while, you sit there scratching your head thinking, I asked for a million of these things and there's only 500,000. What's going on? So if you use the sequential distribution to do your initial inserts, it will just go one after the other and you'll get however many you ask for, as long as the clustering and so forth allows that number of results there. So it makes things a bit more predictable when you're doing the inserts. So that's it. And then the final thing in here is the cluster setting, if you like. So time was, if I just go back to my table thing, time is the clustering key for this table. The others are all the partition key part. So by saying cluster fixed 15, that means there will be 15 rows in each partition, or 15 values for the clustering key per partition. So you can actually do the maths and work out how many rows in total this could potentially generate by just multiplying if you start at one for all of them, it'd be multiplying the maximum population value or multiplying the number in each population. So 15 times 1,000 times 288 times 600 would be the total data set that this spec is capable of generating. If you run more operations than that, if you run inserts up to that number, you'll get new data. If you go over that, then it'll start writing over itself because it just can't generate any more than that. So that's the column spec specifies your population basically. And then the next sections are the insert and query sections. So the first thing on insert is, so for insert, when you run it, there's basically just one way of running inserts. You can't specify different insert commands, and it inserts data for the full set of columns. It does inserts in batches. So the first thing you tell it is how many partitions per batch to do. And when it picks up a partition, it basically tries to insert the whole partition worth of data subject to the select down below. So in this case, I've said always just one partition per batch. The batch type, logged or unlogged, which is just for testing the different things there. And then select is what portion of the batch should go into each insert. So in this case, because I've said 10 out of 10, every operation would insert the full partition. But if I said, say, 1 out of 15, because it's 15 clustering keys per partition, then it would just insert one row out of each batch there. So the kind of thing to know here is that when you specify the number of operations for insert, it's inserting, it's counting batches. So if I say insert 100, run 100 insert operations, it will run 100 batches with, in this case, one partition and the full partition. But it depends on what you're selecting through that insert. And then the next thing we do is the queries. So specify just the queries with the question marks where the values get substituted in, which you're probably familiar with. The main difference there is same row and multi-row. Same row means it will pick a set of values to substitute in that it knows all exist in one particular row of the generated data of the keys, so it's guaranteed to hit at least a potential row. Hopefully it doesn't guarantee that you've already inserted that row when you get to this. Multi-row just randomly picks values from the potential population, so even if you'd inserted the entire potential population, you may not hit a valid value. Okay, just wrapping up, a few final tips, a couple of things I thought learned along the way. Basically, two ways of controlling the level of load with Cassandra Stress, which may not be obvious at first. First one is to use the number of threads, so the more threads you have on the client, the greater the load you'll be generating against the server, so because it's all executed synchronously to time it, so that increases, and there's also a throttle equals setting, which again can more directly say run this many operations there, depending on how you do it. Second tip, which again I'd got bitten by a couple of times, when you using the older generation commands, write, read, or mixed, be aware that the number of operations you specify with n equals impacts the population generation. So it'll actually basically, if you do n equals 100, it'll actually only generate 100 values for your population, or n equals a million. And duration defaults to a million as the size of the population. So I actually got bitten by running a 12-hour test thinking, oh, it's going to be writing heaps of data, but actually it was just writing the same million rows over and over again. And I talked about using sequential distribution. Okay, that was kind of the end of my talk. A lot of that stuff is covered in a series of blog posts that I wrote kind of preparing for this talk. So if I went through some of that quickly, you can go to those and actually read that stuff there. I'm still planning to do a couple more in that series, so they will come out. And final plug before questions. We're having a bit of a reception, so if you'd like to come and have a beer with the Instaclustr tech team, there'll be a few of us there in the market room in the Hilton at 7:30 tonight, so it'd be great to meet some people. So that's it. Open for questions.
Your slides don't include the obligatory, are you hiring? Are you hiring?
We're always hiring.
Okay. It was so unusual that your slides did not contain that I had to ask.
Yeah. In Australia mainly, though. It's a nice place to live.
So how do you watch and calculate the cache heat rate?
So there are node tool commands I can't remember which one it is off the top of my head. CF stats maybe, gives you the cache hit rate in Cassandra. With the operating system, I can't remember off the top, but part of it is just, the big thing is knowing that you've got enough data to realistically overflow the cache. So if you make the mistake of only having a small amount of data on disk and doing reads off it, you can think it's going really fast, but actually it's all sitting in the cache. So
to do something similar, and then I try to do the calculation, but I need a way to verify. So I'm curious how you did it, yeah.
Yeah, I'd probably best to take them on offline and talk to you in some more detail, I think, yeah. That's time. Oh, there we go. Thanks, everybody. Hopefully see something tonight.